Welcome back. Your dream was your ticket out. Welcome back to the same old place that you laughed about. Everyone knows a little bit about a whole lot of things. You know, those who don't follow technology know enough about the new iPhone release. Those who don't know a thing about video games know enough about Nintendo and Mario. Those who aren't familiar with professional wrestling know that, you know, that's the thing that Hulk Hogan does. And when it comes to architecture, we know that's the thing Frank Lloyd Wright used to do. Howdy, hey there, and hello. I'm Montez McCrary, the practitioner. And on this week's architecture-focused episode of Practitioner Documented, or Docked, we're going to be discussing... Oh yeah, that's right. Docked is back! And this time around, Docked will now be a bi-monthly series with a new episode every second and fourth Friday, which I thought was a pretty nice way to kick off 2015. And if I get any jokes or references about either hoverboards or self-lacing tennis shoes, since it is 2015, I will find you, and I will end you. Enough is enough. Anyways, on this episode of Docked, we'll be discussing the life, architectural styles, and legacy of Frank Lloyd Wright. Now, let's get... Oh, come on! Okay, good. Now, let's get nerdy. Frank Lloyd Wright was born Frank Lincoln Wright in the town of Richland Center, Wisconsin, in the United States in 1867. His mother, Anna, a trained teacher, bought a set of educational blocks for her family, and Wright spent much of his time playing with these blocks. These were geometrically shaped, and they could be assembled in various combinations to form three-dimensional compositions. This is how Wright described, in his autobiography, the influence of these exercises on his own approach to design. Quote, "For several years, I sat at the little kindergarten tabletop and played with the cube, the sphere, and the triangle, these smooth wooden maple blocks. All are in my fingers to this day. In fact, many of his buildings are notable for their geometrical clarity." Wright was admitted to the University of Wisconsin-Madison as a special student in 1886, but he left the school without taking a degree, although he was granted an honorary doctorate of fine arts from the same university in 1955, and Wright arrived in Chicago in search of employment. Now, as a result of the devastating Great Chicago Fire of 1871 and the recent population boom, new developments were plentiful in the city, and he was hired as a draftsman with a couple of architectural firms in the city, including the architectural firm of Joseph Lyman Silsby to Dagmar Attler and Louis Sullivan. Wright was a writer, an art collector, a philosopher, as well as a visionary, and these all inspired his approach to architecture. His belief that buildings should be made from the land and benefit the land inspired most of his work. Now, these beliefs, avant-garde for his time, are still practiced and revered to this day. Interesting note, Wright strongly believed in individualism in architecture and did not affiliate with the American Institute of Architects, the AIA, during his career, going so far as to call the organization, quote, "a harbor of refuge for the incompetent and a form of refined gangsterism." In fact, when an associate referred to him as an old amateur, Wright confirmed, "I am the oldest." Now, Wright is widely known for four styles of buildings, all of which grew and evolved from its predecessor. There was the prairie style, the textile style, the organic style, and the Usonian style. First off, he conceived of the prairie style, which was born out of his belief that we need fewer, larger rooms which flowed more easily. His antithesis, I guess you would say, to the rigid, confined, and closed-in Victorian-era architecture. Now, the prairie style incorporates low-pitched roofs, overhanging eaves, a central chimney, open floor plans, no attics or basements, and generally long rows of casement windows that further emphasize the horizontal theme of the homes or other buildings. Now, some of Wright's most important residential works of that time were the Darwin D. Martin House in Buffalo, New York, the Avery Cooney House in Riverside, Illinois, the Frederick C. Robey House, a favorite of mine, in Chicago, the Larkin Company Administration Building in Buffalo, built in 1903 but demolished 47 years later in 1950, and the Unity Temple in Oak Park, Illinois. Also, one of my other favorites. And from the prairie style, he transitioned into the textile style, which took on an even more linear approach combined with influences from Mayan architecture. In fact, in the 1920s, Frank Lloyd Wright developed and designed a number of houses in California using precast 16-inch by 16-inch textile concrete blocks reinforced by an internal system of bars. Now, Wright first used this textile block system on the John Storer House in Hollywood, California in 1923, and later in the Samuel Freeman House and the Ennis House. Now, the textile block system arose from Wright's desire to wed machine-age production techniques with organic architecture, putting them together like peanut butter and chocolate. The principle that a structure should look as though it was naturally grown from the site, which is not what peanut butter and chocolate do, so as to make the designs affordable to people of modest means. The textile style led way to Wright's organic style, which drew from natural resources combined with the influence of Japanese architecture. Now, Taliesin West, which was Wright's winter home and studio complex in Scottsdale, Arizona, is practically built with local materials from the ground, you know, the natural terrain, upward, you know, becoming one with the land. Now, perhaps this is most especially true of the home Falling Water, where the house and the land truly have merged to become one. Now, Wright desired to place the occupants close to the natural surroundings with a stream of water and a waterfall running through and under part of the building. And he wanted the new residents to live with the waterfalls, so pretty much making the waterfall part of their everyday lives, which in fact makes nature part of their everyday lives. Also, in turn, the organic style transitioned and led to the Usonian style, which was intended to be highly practical, independent, low cost for middle class clients to be run without the need of servants. Now, the homes featured small kitchens called workspaces that adjoined the dining spaces. Now, these spaces, a lot of spaces, in turn flowed into the main living areas that were outfitted with built-in seating and tables. Now, similar to the prairie houses, Usonian living areas focus on the fireplace. Bedrooms are typically isolated and they were relatively small in order to encourage the family to gather in the main living areas, following the conception of spaces instead of rooms. Some Usonian homes include the Hanna Honeycomb House, built in 1937 in Palo Alto, California, with the honeycomb planting grid, now you know where the name came from, and his final Usonian home, the Gordon House, that was completed in 1963. In total, fewer than 60 of Wright's Usonian houses were actually built. Wright passed away on April 9, 1959 at the age of 91, shortly after undergoing surgery in Phoenix, Arizona to remove an intestinal obstruction, and 6 months before his iconic Guggenheim Museum in New York opened its doors. Now, later in his life, as well as after his death in 1959, Wright received much honorary recognition for his lifetime achievements. Wright's only skyscraper project, the Price Tower, is a 19-story tower built in 1956 in Bartlesville, Oklahoma. He received the Gold Medal Awards from the Royal Institute of British Architects in 1941 and the American Institute of Architects Gold Medal in 1949. In fact, the AIA Gold Medal was a symbolic burying of the hatchet between Wright and the AIA. In a radio interview, Wright commented, quote, "Well, the AIA, I never joined, and they know why. And when they gave me the gold medal in Houston, I told them frankly why. Feeling that the architecture profession is all that's the matter with architecture, why should I join them?" Unquote. He was awarded the Franklin Institute's Frank P. Brown Medal in 1953. He received honorary degrees from several universities, including, as I mentioned earlier, his alma mater, University of Wisconsin, and several nations named him as an honorary board member to their National Academies of Art and or Architecture. In 2000, Falling Water was named the building of the 20th century in an unscientific top 10 poll taken by members attending the AIA annual convention in Philadelphia. On that list, Wright was listed along with many of the United States' other great architects, including Errol Saracen, Ian Pei, Louis Kahn, Philip Johnson, and Ludwig Mies van der Rohe. and he was the only architect who had more than one building on the list. The other three buildings on that list were the Guggenheim Museum in New York City, the Frederick C. Robey House in Chicago, and the Johnson Wax Building. And ladies and gentlemen, that was dot number, come on! Okay. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that was Docked Episode 13 on Frank Lloyd Wright. Stay tuned in 2 weeks for Docked Episode 14. Thanks for tuning in, everyone. Please like, love, share the video, add it to your favorites. Subscribe to the Practitioner channels on Blip, Daily Motion, and YouTube. And you can follow me on all the social networks. Check out thepractitioner.com for all the nerdy geekery on architecture, technology, video games, professional wrestling, and other randomness. And if you have an opinion or something you'd like to share and or add, leave a comment below this video and on thepractitioner.com. You can support The Practitioner by going to thepractitioner.com and or by clicking those Amazon US, Amazon Canada, ThinkGeek, and other affiliate links below to shop at those places and support this channel and the website. So I'll see you guys next time, and remember to stay true to yourselves, stay blessed, and stay nerdy.